The Commission on Higher Education welcomes discussions on the free college education program. See, Finance Secretary Benjamin Diokno earlier pushed for a review of the measure, saying the current scheme is inefficient and wasteful. But for CHED Chairman Prospero De Vera, critics should instead look at why government is implementing the program in the first place.
If the policy of the government is to increase access and equity in higher education, then the free higher education law is the right way to do it. You know, access is very critical. We have to give more possibilities for more Filipinos to get university education. There is already evidence there to make a real assessment and discussion of the free higher education law. No? So I have in fact taken this up in the Education Commission of the House and the Senate now, and I asked them to make this one of the major areas for review in the EDCOM. I think that is the best platform to discuss the issue.
There are also concerns poor students are losing their slots since those who can afford to pay are also benefiting from the measure. But De Vera points out the situation in state universities and colleges outside Metro Manila is very different.
UP is one of more than 100 public universities. The enrollment of UP is not even 1 or 2% of the total enrollment in higher ed. The total enrollment is close to 2 million. Should we impose what we think of UP for the less than 1% for the 99% of universities? I have always asked the critics of free higher ed, join me as I go to the different campus of the different public universities. The profile of the students is that they're not rich. And for many families all over the country, the only chance to get your child educated, and I'm not talking of very poor families, I'm talking of Philippine families. The only chance to get your child educated is to go to a public university.
The Senate Finance Committee approves the proposed 2024 budget for the Vice President's office and the Education Department she concurrently heads. Vice President Sara Duterte defended the inclusion of confidential funds in her budgets. Sherry Antores reports.
It was not smooth sailing for the office of the Vice President when they faced the Senate Finance Committee on Monday as they presented their proposed 2024 budget.
Unlike some members of the House Appropriations Panel, senators were able to scrutinize the OVP's budget, particularly its confidential funds.
Senator Rizon de Veros asks how the OVP plans to use their confidential funds. Vice President Duterte says their CIF bankrolls programs like tree planting, free bus rides, livelihood and calamity assistance, and surveillance activities in communities.
We did surveillance of complaints from constituents in Bulacan with regard to the selling of OVP assistance and the selling of TUPAD projects. We were able to apprehend the person and we were able to successfully prosecute the case.
But Ontiveros is unconvinced, arguing intelligence activities should be left to the experts. The vice president admits they can live without the confidential funds, but it gives them flexibility in ensuring their projects are properly implemented.
Our work will be much easier if we have the flexibility of confidential funds in monitoring the safe, secure, and successful implementations of the programs, projects, and activities of the Office of the Vice President.
In the same hearing, the Vice President also confirms receiving a 221 million peso fund from the Office of the President last year, which serve as their CIF.
Vice President Duterte says they have submitted a report to the Office of the President, Senate President, House Speaker, and Commission on Audit on how it was spent.
That is practically an augmentation, di ba? Na we added something to the tune of, I think of the 221 million the OVP liquidated 125 million as confidential funds. How do we justify or reason out this situation?
I think the Department of Budget and Management can better answer the question of the transfer of funds from their source to the office of the Vice President.
Pimentel says Senate President Juan Miguel Zubiri will soon convene a Congressional Oversight Committee hearing on confidential and intelligence funds.
The hearing was suspended for several minutes, and when it resumed, Administration Senators Ramon Revilla Jr., Christopher Goh, Jingoy Estrada, and Ronald De La Rosa all moved to approve the OVP proposed budget. This was seconded by Senator Sunny Angara, who is the chairman of the Senate Finance Committee.
The Vice President, who is also concurrent Education Secretary, also presented her agency's proposed budget amounting to 758.6 billion pesos, which include a 150 million confidential funds. These two was challenged by the Senate minority.
Sa aling mga subjects o sa aling mga entities magfo-focus ang DepEd sa kanyang surveillance o intelligence gathering efforts?
Your Honor, this will be directed in the anti-insurgency, in the anti-terrorism and violent extremism, with regard to pornography, child pornography, drugs cases, criminality, and gangsterism, as well as other sexual exploitation complaints and reports.
The issue of the lack of classrooms was also raised. DepEd officials say they would need 420 billion pesos to complete the 159,000 classroom backlog. Education Undersecretary Epimaco Densing says half a million new enrollees join the country's student population every year. The DepEd budget was later approved by the Senate Finance Committee and has been referred for plenary discussion. Sherian Torres, ABS-CBN News.
The budget briefing for the Office of the President breezes past the House Appropriations Committee. Our very own RG Cruz now joins us with details. RG, go ahead.
Hi, Carmina. Just as it did for the Office of the Vice President, the House Appropriations Committee ended the budget briefing for the Office of the President with no questions asked. In under an hour, leaving behind over $4 billion in confidential intelligence funds intact, comprising almost half of the 10.7 billion peso OP budget. After former Chief Justice Turned Executive Secretary Lucas Bersamin delivered his opening presentation, as head of the OP delegation, ABRA Representative Chin Bernos moved to end the deliberation, which is tantamount to committee approval of the OP budget. Of course, members of the Makabayan Bloc tried their best to object, but the majority prevailed, and the budget briefing for the OP was still terminated. Still, they were given a chance towards the end of the particular session to manifest their objections. Basically, the members of the Makabayan Bloc cited or slammed their colleagues for invoking parliamentary courtesy again, just as it did in the case of the Office of the Vice President last week, as they insisted on their right to scrutinize the budget. Now, with this development done, the OP's budget will next be scrutinized at the plenary level when the entire budget bill goes to the plenary session in 2 weeks' time.
All rice vendors have begun implementing the government-mandated price cap on the staple grain. Our very own Jervis Manaha now joins us with that story. Jervis, what more can you tell us?
Yes, Carmina, officials from various agencies did an inspection in two markets earlier this morning, which is the first day of the implementation of the price ceiling for rice. Retailers are forced to follow the price ceiling despite losses they will potentially incur. They say they lose 8 to 10 pesos of potential profit for every kilogram of rice they sell. This is, however, good for the consumers as they got to buy price. They got to buy rice at a lower price. Supplies in Mega Q-Mart in Quezon City ran out fast. Officials said they are coming up with a list of affected retailers so they can give out financial aid as soon as possible. The DSWD says they have funds ready for distribution. Local government units will also come up with their own assistance to affected traders. Retailers say they need the financial assistance as soon as possible as they are losing a lot of money because of the price ceiling. The Metro Manila Council, MMDA, Officials from the Department of Agriculture and the DTI were all present in the inspection. They are asking traders to cooperate and help in lowering the price of rice in the country.
The Banco Central expects inflation to remain elevated in the coming months due to continued supply shocks. It says the inflation outlook is leaning towards the upside due to the potential impact of additional transport fare increases, wage adjustments, as well as higher toll rates affecting prices of key agricultural items. The PSB adds it stands ready to adjust its monetary policy stance to prevent the further broadening of price pressures. The National Economic and Development Authority for Ritz Bart assuring the public government will strengthen measures to ensure food security, protect consumers, and provide assistance to farmers. NEDA Chief Arsenio Balisacan has also called for a review of the existing tariff levels on rice to help lower the cost of the staple and ease the burden on consumers. After six straight months of decline, inflation in the Philippines once again accelerates. The consumer price index came in at 5.3% in August, up from July's 4.7% reading. This brings the average inflation for 2023 to 6.6%. The spike was mainly driven by faster increases in food prices, including rice, as well as the consecutive oil price hikes in August.
The upsides are definitely there already. You know, it's getting more pronounced as we saw. It's not the core inflation side anymore. No? So we're seeing the supply problem crop up once again. And unsurprisingly, it's the food basket that's driving it once more. Inflation, nonetheless, will still probably hit the target. No? But you know, it can get pushed back. Right? Instead of expecting it at October, we might probably see it at November, December.